Now, for further analysis of the Dalai case, the Lil case, and its attendant implications, Christian Luprecht, an associate professor at Queen's University and the Royal Military College of Canada, joins us from Kingston, Ontario. Good morning, Christian, or good afternoon, I should say.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks for being here. Well, the first question that jumped everyone's mind is that this is obviously a precedent-setting case based on the new legislation that was put in place after 9/11. Since this is the first application of this law, it obviously speaks to the fact that we do not normally see spying of this nature take place in Canada. Now, is that because of diligence on our part or a lack of spying in our country?
Well, certainly, I mean, we're under constant threat, especially in the cyber domain, but it shows that we need to be vigilant also on the human intelligence side, that human intelligence continues to be a major sort of threat to our national security. And this is part of the reason why Secrets of Information Act was revamped 10 years ago, in order to bring it up to date and to bring it in line with the new realities of spying and espionage in the 21st century. And no matter what you do, every now and then, something is going to slip through the cracks somewhere, whether that's Bradley Manning in the United States or whether that's the Jeff DeLille case here in Canada. And so what we can do is try to learn from those experiences, revamp our security measures, and try to reassure both ourselves and our allies that this at least of this type of nature, will not recur.
Well, because of this application with this law and this being the first case as such, Christian, they're calling this precedent setting. Now, was the sentence enough to be a precedent or a deterrent in this case?
Well, so there's two separate aspects to that question. So it's precedent setting in the sense that we live in a common law system. In the common law system, we don't know how exactly law enforcement and the judiciary are to apply law until we actually have case law from which we then can infer how future cases are to be judged. And in that regard, this case is particularly important, not just because it is the first case where somebody is tried and convicted under this particular act and the provision in this act, but also because this is a sentence where the judge basically said it didn't matter how much damage was done. All that mattered was that the individual rationally and in a calculated fashion breached the trust that was accorded to him in this particular case. So that is to say that the Crown did not have to establish what extent of damage and harm was done. And this is very important because it suggests that if the Crown would have had to establish that, it would have meant the Crown would have had to divulge evidence on both what we have and possibly the methods by which that evidence was gathered, thus possibly further jeopardizing our national security. And I think the judge here recognized that the onus was simply on the Crown to demonstrate that a breach happened in this particular case, and that had already been established by virtue of the plea that had been arranged with the defendant. And given that, in light of that breach, such a stiff sentence was handed down, I think this will, and so this is the second part of your question, mm-hmm. will act as a serious deterrent for anybody who might possibly think of engaging in this type of activity. And there's always psychologically two dimensions to this. One is people who might actually act on something or people who might be thinking about acting on something. And we know from psychological research that what you think is not necessarily a good predictor of what you're actually going to do. And I think this sentence will have a serious deterrent even for people who might be thinking about engaging in this type of activity of not doing so.
Well, Christian, based on the answer to the first part of the question, and I thank you for being so full and fulsome in your answer, is this. How can we ever determine what the impact of DeLille's crimes will ever be then?
Well, I think this is part of the reason why the Crown wanted a plea bargain here, so that it wouldn't have to divulge all the evidence at work here. But I think the important aspect about this is not necessarily for all Canadians to know what the impact of the crime is. I think the important messages here are to Canadians and to our allies that we take such breaches very seriously, that we have effective rule of law measures in place, and that we also have an effective independent judiciary that can deal with these measures. Remember that this is an individual who got charged, tried, and convicted in about a year, whereas other individuals such as Bradley Manning in the United States has been languishing in jail for quite some time longer than that. So it shows the efficacy and ability of our Canadian court system to do with that. It also sends a message to our adversaries that this particular sentence dramatically raises the costs of spying in Canada because the conviction is going to be swift and is going to be harsh. And so for anybody who would try to recruit human intelligence in this country. It has just made that all the more difficult. And so this is why this is a very strong message that the judge is looking to send here. Let's remember that this is not your average Canadian. This is not the Moment Khawaja or Toronto 18. This was a civil servant who had sworn an oath to the Crown. This was a civil servant who was cleared for top secret, who had signed a form saying he would not betray that trust, and so who knew exactly what he was engaging in. And I think this is why the judge is treating this as such a serious and clear-cut matter.
Christian, we're running out of time, but I want to get your answer to this last question real quick. Was this also a message to our allies?
Absolutely. I think there had been sort of some concern about, you know, is there sort of a leaky vessel or so here? And I think we can clearly demonstrate this is a one-off case. Every now and then this is bound to happen. But it's also clearly a case where we had seen some criticism over the sort of the past weeks of seeping out of the U.S. that if somebody engaged in this type of activity in the United States, they would go away for a very long time. And given that, I mean, the Crown asked for a minimum sentence of 20 years. And it seems like in this trial, as if the defense basically didn't show up, because it seems that all the mitigating circumstances that were listed by the defense, that his marriage was falling apart and he was having financial troubles and whatnot, and that he's not likely to reoffend, that these were not taken into consideration in the sentencing. And so it suggests that the judge was wholly convinced by the Crown's argument about the necessity to send a very strong deterrent message, and a very strong message also to our allies about how seriously we take this particular case. And the judge fully recognizing that here's somebody who's 41 years old. By the time he gets out of jail, his life will be done and he will be an old man, and notwithstanding the fact that he has children and whatnot. So I think this is a very strong message to send to our allies about how vigorous the Canadian justice system deals with this in an open court, fair trial, rule of law, independent judiciary fashion. And in the age of national security and terrorism, I think this is also a very important message to send, that we can try even the harshest and most vigorous cases in Canada under an open rule of law fashion. And I mean, the judge called this individual a traitor. It's hard to imagine tougher language from a Canadian judge with regards to sentencing and convicting an individual like this.
No question about that. Christian, as always, we appreciate your insight and your expertise. Thanks for this.
My pleasure.
That was Christian Luprecht. He's an associate professor at Queen's University on the Royal Military College of Canada.